Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this wonderful event, our first event of 2020 from Nine Arches Press. I'm Jane Kermaid, and I'm absolutely delighted to be hosting this wonderful launch this evening for 100 Lockdown Sonnets, Jacqueline Saphra's wonderful collection of poems written during the first lockdown. It's been published in this beautiful hardback edition of just 100 to mark our 100th publication. So you can probably see what we did there with our wonderful centenary celebrations with our publications. It's a real delight to be hosting this event this evening. We have an incredible lineup of readers tonight joining us, as well as Jaqueline Saphra reading from her sonnets. We have a wonderful lineup, including Jacob Samler-Rose, Miriam Nash, Anja Konig. And on video, we're also being joined by Ian McMillan and Naomi Shihab. So I'm absolutely delighted to be launching this wonderful book this evening, and especially delighted to be launching it in such wonderful company. In a moment, I will pass over to Jaqueline, who's going to introduce each of the poets who are going to read tonight. And the lovely thing is we will have one poem from each poet of their own. We will also have a sonnet that they have chosen from Jaqueline's 100 sonnets as well. So that's hopefully a wonderful way of celebrating this really quite extraordinary and beautiful book. So to say a few words first before we go further about how the book came about why we're all here this evening as well, and to welcome our readers and our audience as well. So first of all, to say hello to everybody on YouTube. It's really wonderful to be in your company this evening, and we can see all of your messages. So please do post. It's wonderful to see where you are. So I can see already we've got people in Paris, Surrey, Kent, Andalusia, Brixton, San Antonio, Glasgow, wet North London, the Thames Valley, Nine Elms, Manchester. Thank you, everybody. It's wonderful to get a real sense of where you are all joining us from this evening. And although we are all sort of in lockdown again across the UK, we are gathering around the glow of our computer screens to share poetry, which feels like a really important thing to be doing. And it's just wonderful to be in your company this evening. So thank you for joining us. So last year on lockdown, Jaqueline Saphra gave herself something of a challenge, which was to keep a journal of the experience of the first lockdown here in the UK on the 23rd of March. That became a series of sonnets, one written every day, usually one responding to the news, the headlines that were taking place, and using the sonnet form as a container into which to pour the experiences of each strange day. Following Jaqueline sending me the manuscript, I was really interested to think about this collection of poems and how they might work. And Jaqueline and I talked about it and felt very much that this was an interesting, unusual and slightly different book from many that we had published before. That also, in terms of Jaqueline's own work, it's a really fascinating piece of work that documents the experience of those days in a very particular and really thought-provoking way. So when I suddenly made the connection one morning that we had our 100th publication coming up, every Nine Arches book has a little number on it, usually on the back or in this case on the spine of the book, that we had Jaqueline's 100 sonnets also, and what might happen if we were to publish just 100 of those. So I rang up Jaqueline and we had a really lovely conversation. I said, I've had this idea. I don't know what you think. And that idea turned into this wonderful project and publishing this beautiful book. And the other thing to mention also has been that we didn't just want to publish it, we wanted to do something slightly special with it, to have a limited number, but also do a bit of good with that limited number of books that we were going to publish. I'm really delighted to say that we've been supporting the Trussell Trust with the sales of this book. Every single one has put £16 towards the Trussell Trust and has enabled us to reach a target of £2,000, which we're going to donate to the Trussell Trust. So really thrilled to have that, and ever so pleased that we've been able to do something with this book that is both about documenting those times but also has hopefully made a real difference to some of the people who are finding these a very challenging and difficult time at the moment. And Trussell Trust was a charity that supports food banks and aims to end food poverty and hunger in the UK, so it's a charity that both Jaqueline and I felt very close to our hearts. In a moment, I'm going to welcome all of our poets onto the screen and we're going to wave cheerily at you. And then Jaqueline is going to introduce each of the poets and the readings for this evening. And I'll just add that if you have been one of the lucky 100 people who have purchased one of these beautiful books, thank you. We really appreciate it. It has made a real, real difference to the charity. We hope to be able to donate that money towards them. And also you have this beautiful book to enjoy. Also, they'll be going out in the post in the coming week. Also, just to say, if you haven't bought one or would like to donate or would like to pop some money into the Trussell Trust to support the amazing work they do, we're going to post into the YouTube chat a link. Normally at book events and launches, we buy each other a nice glass of wine or a cup of coffee or a slice of cake. So perhaps if everybody had, could donate maybe £2 or £3 towards the Trussell Trust, you might help us hit our £500 stretch target, which would be incredible. Thank you ever so much. We do appreciate it if you're able to do that. It's very much appreciated of you. But in the meantime, without further ado, may I welcome the wonderful Jaqueline Saphra, who this evening will introduce and host a wonderful selection of readings. Please take it away, Jaqueline.
I feel like there should be a kind of fanfare or something, but of course there isn't. But what I do have here are my family, who are all sitting on the sofa, and I'm hoping very much that they're going to do a little bit of whooping and cheering to start this off. They are there. They can only whoop a little bit because we have to get on. So thank you, Jane, for keeping the faith with this book and being willing to publish it at fairly short notice. I think that probably Jane may feel a little similar to me, that I feel a bit like that woman who didn't realise she was pregnant and then suddenly had a baby. It's the process has felt very quick and very intense. And I'm so glad to have had the opportunity to write the sonnets and then to publish them so quickly. I also want to say thanks to everyone who bought the book, supported the venture, read the poems as they were going along, retweeted them, resonated with them, and in some cases published them. It's been an amazing journey so far, and the book is absolutely beautiful because Jane, as well as being a great editor, is also the most fantastic book designer. And we also have the wonderful cover and inside illustrations by the magnificent Sophie Herxheimer. So thank you, Sophie. It's a continual surprise to me every time I go back to this sequence to reread it and remember things that I had forgotten along the way. It also feels a bit like Groundhog Day, like we're on our third lockdown now and things feel quite similar, but a little bit, you know, kind of more apathetic, a bit more less confident and definitely colder. But here we are again. And I must say that although this book was charting lockdown, it is a journey of ups and downs. I think life for most of us has been, I certainly have gone from euphoria to despair from one day to the next. And I think some of these poems reflect that. I'm particularly proud and particularly honoured to be introducing five brilliant poets to you this evening. Each will read one of their poems and one from the sonnets. Each of them is distinguished for me by the quality of their work first, but secondly, for the generosity of their spirits and also, of course, their support of me and my work. And I think each of them in their own ways really exemplifies the network and the web of solidarity and support that represents the very best of the poetry world. And honestly, when I started putting their biographies together, I was somewhat awestruck, because you think you know everything about people and you discover all kinds of amazing things that they are doing and have done. And it's a very eminent and wonderful bunch of people, humble as well. So before I read my first sonnet, I just want to read a very short quote from the magnificent poet and shaman, W.S. Merwin, who was born in 1927, died only in 2019, was a practicing Buddhist. And what he said was, I think there's a kind of desperate hope built into poetry now that one really wants, hopelessly, to save the world. One is trying to say everything that can be said for the things that one loves while there's still time. He says, I think that's a social role, don't you? We keep expressing our anger and our love, and we hope, hopelessly, perhaps, that it will have some effect. So that was W.S. Merwin, and I guess, you know, that's what most of us are trying to do, most of us who write or create in some way, to express our anger and our love and hope that it has some effect. So, sonnet one, I'm just going to read you this one before I pass you over to our first guest. Sonnet one is from the 23rd of March, 2020. And like most of the sonnets, there's a little epigraph. In this case, it's from The Guardian. PM, stay at home. This is a national emergency. I'm sure that many of you can remember sitting on your sofas getting that message. And you'll hear that I'm beginning to try to get to terms with the language of lockdown, the language of pandemic. I'm standing at the starting line. Am I allowed to share my shadows if I disinfect? How do I dodge the shedders in the crowd, the howls of strangers? Watch me attempt the daily joy of blossoms, pink of hope before they fall. Ditch the questions, wait, inhale the spring, ascend the hopeful slope to summer, then wander home to isolate. Oh, small, unwholesome sofa, keep me safe. Don't make me scroll again for risk and grief. Instead, I'll do the work. Try to be brave, return to what I love, pen scratch of faith. I'll let the sonnet school me like a child learning the language, open and purified. And I think Miriam lets the sonnet school her like a child, open and purified. Miriam Nash, I describe as one of my poetry soul sisters. We first met, she was a member of an online forum set up by Jacob Sam LaRose, who you'll be hearing from later. It's called The Vineyard, and it was a vital part of my poetic development, my journey. And Miriam has been there all the way along. We've watched each other's parallel journeys, and we've swapped work, and we've argued ourselves into tears in cafes talking about poetry, because poetry really matters to both of us. Miriam was one of the people on the 100 sonnet journey with me. She read the sonnet, she cheered, she never criticized, because I forbade her to do that during that process. That came later. And she was often writing her own sonnets as well. And I think you're going to hear one of them this evening, one that I particularly love. Miriam's a fine educator. She's a mentor herself. She's a teacher. She's a warm and generous soul, as well as being a fantastic poet. She was a producer at Shake the Dust many years ago, big teenage slam, which was also which Jacob Sam LaRose was also involved in. I say all these things because, you know, we're all linked in very many ways. Miriam and I both had books published by Flipped Eye, our first books, and Jacob edited both of them. Miriam's first collection won an Eric Gregory Award and a Somerset Maugham Award. It's called All the Prayers in the House, and it's one I return to often for love and for sustenance. And now Miriam and I are both published by Hercules Editions as well. Her recent book, Nine Mothers of Haim Dalar, is published also by Hercules. So when I think of Miriam in that other world, I think of drinking tea in cafes. I think of reading poetry together on sofas. Wish we could do that again. And I think of Miriam at the Ledbury Poetry Festival and cobbled streets and brightly coloured bunting. I'm very proud to introduce Miriam Nash.
Thank you so much, Jackie, and congratulations. It is such an honour and a joy to be here this evening to celebrate this beautiful book that I am so excited to hold in my hands. And it is a true honour, and I feel so blessed to be your friend and your poetry sister. Thank you. throughout the time when Jackie was writing these sonnets, she sent me one every day. She never missed a day. She would send them to me by text, so I would receive them at different times of the day. And through many months, it became something for me to really hold on to. I knew each day I was going to receive a poem, and it was going to do something to my day. It was going to bring me something different. And that was an incredible gift. And I knew that I didn't even need to respond. If I was in a day when I couldn't really respond, I didn't have to. But if I did, and I often was moved to, and I was so happy to have this way of being in touch with Jackie every day, I just had so much to admire about these poems, and I'm excited that you can now experience them as well, as I got to in their first form. I began with Jackie writing the sonnets, a sonnet a day, and I think with quite a lot of gaps of days, I managed about 14, which I think puts Jackie's achievement into perspective. It's incredible, and we're so lucky to have these works with us. I'm going to start by reading one of Jackie's sonnets, the one I've chosen, and it's sonnet 17 from the 8th of April. It has two epigraphs, the first from William Wordsworth. This city now doth like a garment wear the beauty of the morning. And one from Emily Maitlis, BBC Newsnight. They tell us coronavirus is a great leveller. It's not. It's much, much harder if you're poor. A mist has settled on the Thames. The air is clearer than it's been for years. Inhale. Who knew that breath could be so beautiful? The stillness rings like something pure. A gown of water shimmers on the shore. I pause to hold this heaven. Then the pull of change upstream, tuneless bell of piling rigs, the underbelly of the river laid open, her hidden darknesses given to the poetry of super sewer, unromantic, necessary, human waste and wastage managed by maskless men taking their chances for a living wage, the unsung heroes of our sunken age. And the poem of mine I want to share is one that I wrote in the first month of the lockdown, the first lockdown. And I wrote this along with Jackie as she was writing her sonnets. It's called Well Song, and it's dedicated this evening to Jackie and also to our dear friend, Naomi Waddis. Well Song. The singer of the song is sick, the song is well. How does the singer make a well song spring from echoes down the well? Well goes the song by singing. The well is quiet, knowing full well not every song is spell. And you can never tell which song will sink like all the sing-song remedies the singer knows so well. Sing well, O singer, even the wrong song rises to a swell. If only for as long as one well song, may this song sing the singer well. Thank you and huge congratulations to Jackie.
It's really lovely to hear that poem. I just realised I was unmuted. I was just saying how lovely it was to hear the all the different uses of that word well and how it kind of rings, doesn't it? Just like a well. I'm really hoping Naomi Shihab Nye is here. I heard Jane say something about San Antonio, so I think she might be. When I'm looking for compassion and love, but also hard political truths, I turn to the poems of Naomi Shihab Nye, and I know I'm not alone in that. Naomi is the author and editor of more than 30 volumes. She's been awarded so many honours, I don't know where to start. I'm just going to list a few. She's been a Guggenheim Fellow, a Lannan Fellow. She's Chancellor Emeritus for the Academy of American Poets. She's won at least 2 Lifetime Achievement Awards, including one from the National Book Critics Circle. And she's Professor of Creative Writing at Texas State University. Mostly she's just the most brilliant, inspiring poet. And mostly I think of Naomi as being my friend. I'm very fortunate to have her in my life. And when I think of Naomi in the real world, or in the world as it was before, I also think of cake at the LRB, breakfast at Dishoom, and one very hot afternoon we spent wandering the streets of Burlington, Vermont, where we happened to coincide quite coincidentally and ate ice creams together. I know this all sounds a bit food focused, but poetry, I guess, is always on the menu. It's my great honour to introduce this short reading from Naomi, which includes a brand new poem, almost hot off the page. So I give you Naomi Shihab Nye.
I wish I were with you today, Jackie. I cheer for your new book and all your work and your presence in this world. Thank you for inviting me to read one of your poems. From the new book of sonnets, I have selected 30th March 2020. And this poem begins with a quote from BBC News. Citing the 20,000 former NHS staff who have returned to work, and the 750,000 members of the public who have volunteered to help the most vulnerable, croaky-sounding, Boris Johnson said it was proof his conservative predecessor, Margaret Thatcher, was wrong when she famously declared, "There is no such thing as society." And suddenly it's love, no matter who I'm writing to. It used to be warm wishes, kind regards, or yours sincerely. Now it's lots of love with rows of kisses. What's going on? I only have to watch the news to find I'm helplessly adoring half the world. Oh, holy humankind, I'm weak with gratitude. I'm loose like laundry off the line. And if I could, I'd hug the postman and the street sweeper. I'd weep into the stiff neck of the woman at the checkout. I'd smooch the doctor and the nurse before I knew what I was doing. Oh, flamboyant faith. Oh, trusting soul, I am prostrate before you. Keep me whole. Thank you, Jacqueline, for your voice. And my humble poem, which was written last week for a spontaneous poems project here sponsored by Texas Standard Radio. And so I had to just write it out, and then that was it. Mine is called Healing. Lean into it, the breeze suggests. Dig deeper, says the dirt. Sometimes the hurt you feel means you're standing in the wrong place. Move over. This hurt wasn't meant for people. It wasn't meant to land anywhere. It's the cosmic ache of the atmosphere drifting through, the give and take, push-pull flow. You know when it passes, no claiming necessary. The lift of the air. Hear the held note like the quiet humming A an orchestra tunes to. That's for you.
Thank you, Naomi, for that beautiful reading and for what you say, that's for you, for your poetry and for being here for me and for poetry and for all the poets and for the world. We're lucky to have you in it. I'm going to read a few of these poems. Someone did email me earlier today, actually, and said, you know, I'm not sure that I can stay for all 100 poems at the launch. And I wrote back and said, don't worry, I'm just going to read a handful, you know, so don't panic in case you thought you were going to get 100 sonnets. You're not. But I am going to read a selection of them in kind of chronological orders, just so you get a sense of, I guess, the range and the different tones of the different poems. So this is Sonnet 9. It's from the 31st of March. And there are a couple of epigraphs on this one. FTSE 100 suffers worst quarter since 1987 from the BBC News. And from Canary Wharf magazine, March 2020. From quartz massages to giant floating ice baths, here are the top wellness destinations for 2020. So Robin, my husband, and I went for a walk in Canary Wharf round about this time, and it was like a ghost town. But everything, the escalators were still working. It was very peculiar. This could be hell or heaven. Who knows which? We roam your concourses. We marvel at your rooftop gardens and your ghoulish kitsch, your restaurants and bars, your glitzy tat, your automatic escalators still climbing to nowhere. Where are your men in suits, your quick-step waiters, gyms and spin class thrills, your oat milk lattes and your champagne flutes, your breathless trains, your pits and palaces? We stroll amid this air of nothing, blow our cash on faked-up meals on empty terraces as dust settles on your public pianos and your temples. Vermin do their doings and rats claim their rightful place among the ruins. It's amazing how fast things start to fall apart. So this is Sonnet 27 from the 18th of April. It was the point at which everyone was getting into making sourdough bread and looking incredibly productive and showing everybody how useful they were being and all the new things they were learning. And the epigraph from here is, Boris bounces back to get Britain moving. A nice bit of alliteration there from the Daily Mail. My day begins with green, like tea or grass. I'm learning Cantonese and Mandarin. I'm reading Ulysses and Gormenghast and Plato while I'm training to be thin. I'm shedding all my doubts. I'm knitting sieves and sand. I write a symphony a week. I grow my own arugula. I live on air, philosophy, and ancient Greek. I'm breeding ants and sheep and minotaurs to save my mental health. I do not want for company or mutton, wool or horn. The PhD is done. I'm looking hot. James Joyce has said my novel's bloody great, and Mervyn Peake has asked me on a date. So one of the things that happened as I was starting to look for more material was that I started to look at other plagues in history and works of art. And I came across the very famous painting by Salvatore Rosa. Jane, if you could put the image up now, that would be great. We should have this photograph hopefully on the screen in a second. But anyway, the painting is described in the poem. A terrible plague swept through Naples in 1665, the terrible plague that had been going on for for centuries already. And the painter, Salvatore Rosa, lost his baby son, his sister, his sister's husband, and their five children to that plague. And this painting is testament to that. This is Sonnet 50. It's from the 11th of May, and there are three epigraphs here. New York warns of children's illness linked to COVID-19 after three deaths, said the Guardian. And there's an epigraph on the poem itself, on the painting itself. Conception is a sin, birth is pain, life is toil, death a necessity. Apparently he was quite funny, quite comic man, Salvatore Rosa. But in this painting, you don't really see that. Death takes center stage, experienced, adept, emerging from the dark, wing, skull, and grin. The baby boy, obedient, surely not literate, is writing quill in hand as death dictates. The ink is on the page. The mother reads, boy gathered on her lap. She knows she will not save him from the plague. We call it history, but see, snap, snap, death comes again. We think we've beaten him, but find he owns the street, the shop, the school, the theatre, hospital, and birthing room. In this deluded age, the leading role is ours, we think. Nah, we're just the cameo. Death takes the curtain call and steals the show. I think it's worth saying that one of the most difficult things about these Shakespearean sonnets is finding a way into that final couplet, that final rhyming couplet. And this is where I have to give a big thank you to my husband, Robin, who read this particular sonnet and said it wasn't good enough. And he was right. And I changed it, and it's got a lot better. This is Sonnet 63 from the 24th of May. This is one of the angry political poems in the sequence. There are actually quite a few like this. I will not revisit the facts of Dominic Cummings' crimes. I think you all know what those were, but I've got a couple of epigraphs here. Michael Gove saying, caring for your wife and child is not a crime. And the BBC News said, several Conservative MPs have called for the PM's chief advisor, Dominic Cummings, to quit amid claims he broke coronavirus rules. Downing Street does its best to blag, but lacks the teat of milky slogans usually on tap. It's worrying. Robbed of his starring role there, weirdo misfit can't take back control. Where is the big man's voice? Downing Street's crack facade denies, retracts, and tweets. It's not a crime to feed your helpless wife and babe in arms, to take a little drive. But who would suckle on those frozen tits again? Boris? He whines through thirsty grin and rotten teeth. He slurps a curdled hit of risk. His man, still pregnant with advice, just balls his fist and rolls the magic dice of rhetoric. This time, they do not spin. I'm sure you all remember that little conference that he gave in the garden at Downing Street, and how late he was and how feeble his arguments were. Sonnet 83, the 13th of June, and the government were saying things were a lot better and soon we'd all be back to normal. There's an epigraph here from The Guardian. Green King pubs to open with perspex screens and controlled toilets. But a lot of us are thinking that when all this is over, even in this third lockdown, we're thinking we're going to have some big parties, and that's what this sonnet's about. When all the grief is over, we should throw a giant fuck-off party with balloons and tenderness, smooch under the moon, live it up skin to skin and grow our own, get high with everyone we know, share the plate and pass around the spoon, gather face to face, give up on Zoom and live the actual life. Turn off our phones, revert to calling cards and sharabanks, smoke signals, yogurt pots and string. Let's kiss strangers, give the weeds a chance, green the streets together, offer thanks and build some bridges. Those lovely things that everyone's allowed to walk across. I've always loved bridges. This is the sixth poem that I'm going to read you now before I introduce our next guest. So this is the point at which I'd usually say, you know, how are you doing? Are you all okay? And, you know, if we were live, people would say either they were, or maybe if they were being impolite, they might say they weren't. But I'm just assuming you're all with me here as I come into this sixth poem. So this is Sonnet 88. This is the 18th of June, 2020. Again, can we trust our government? They're telling us everything is going to be all right. Don't really believe a word of it. A lot of these poems are partly about how we operate as artists in this situation, and whether what we have to offer, me trying to understand why poetry still matters. The singer of We'll Meet Again, who entertained troops in World War II, has died, said the BBC News. The anthropologists will have their day. History will come for us. We don't know what we're living through. We see only how high the walls, how fake the news, how deep the rut. We dizzy in our twisting narratives. We try to find the light. Our working heads knock out a plot. We track and trace. Our gifts are all we've got, and Vera Lynn is dead. End of an era, myth of a common cause, and what's the bloody point of art? Oh, please, who else will tell the whip and wheeze? Our loss must not be of imagination. The libraries of the mind are open. The alchemy is strong. The dark dream howls and shows its teeth. Bring it on. Well, the alchemy is certainly strong in the poetry of my next guest, Jacob Sam LaRose. His pamphlet Communion was a Poetry Book Society choice. His collection Breaking Silence was nominated for the Forward Prize and has its place on the A-level syllabus. Jacob is a quiet and determined force, mentor to many young poets. He's been artistic director of the London Teenage Poetry Slam, Apples and Snakes World Cup, and Shake the Dust, where you may remember Miriam also worked. He also lectures at Guildhall and Goldsmiths, and here he is at my book launch. Jacob happened to be at what I think was my first public reading. My first open mic, in fact, and came up to me afterwards to say how much he'd enjoyed my poem. That meant a great deal to me at the time, and still his good thoughts really matter to me. He set up the Vineyard, where I met Miriam, and we shared and critiqued our poems over several years, and where I really built my craft. Jacob also edited my first book, The Kitchen of Lovely Contraptions. And when I think of Jacob before all this, I think of the editorial meeting we had at the South Bank, face to face, where he went through my manuscript with a mind like a razor. I think of regular sightings at big poetry events where I always ask, hopeful of a new book, Jacob. Still writing, I say, and he dependably says, of course, always writing. So I'm excited to hear what he's going to read for you tonight, and it's an honour and a privilege to introduce to you Jacob Sam LaRose.
Wow, absolutely wow. It's a joy to be here in celebration of Jacqueline Saphra and the sonnets that Jacqueline has produced. I'm hearing all the references to the sonnets, and I'm realizing that all of the references are overwriting my memory of Shakespearean sonnets. I'm hearing sonnet 50 being referenced, and there's another Shakespearean sonnet that's now been replaced entirely by a Jacqueline Saphra original. So, Jacqueline, you've brought back many memories. The reference to the vineyard, wow, that was an age, that was an era in the time before. And the reference to so many of these things. And it's just a joy to have been able to walk the path alongside you at different points. And again, to be here to celebrate this work. So I am going to read. I have selected sonnet 59. Forget the Shakespearean one. This is the Jacqueline Saphra one. 20th of May. It's preceded by an epigraph from The Guardian. And the epigraph reads, "Europe should brace for second wave, says EU coronavirus chief." Sonnet 59. Remember Brick Lane Sundays? Bagel bake, garam masala, artisan baristas, sellers of hip and vintage on the make, the smell of weed, the Sunday lager drinkers, trestle tables, strangers skin to skin, the men who stood outside the curry houses, flaunting menus, beckoning you in, how you walked by, assailed by choice. Remember Shadwell Station and the sight of dealers on the corner, fried chicken round the clock, the homeless begging late at night, how you never liked the overground. Remember how you wished the world would change? Remember when the trains were just the trains? Yeah. And so Jacqueline made reference to this would be the point when, and this would be the point when, and this would be the point when everyone's like, oh, poem. Wow, beautiful. Absolutely is. I am going to now move on to a poem of my own. Jacqueline, sorry to disappoint, this is not a new poem. There are new poems, yes, always writing, but this isn't a new one. This is a poem I'd forgotten that I'd written. I found it again very recently, thought about it for this event, decided I wasn't going to read it, and then decided I was going to read it. And when I wrote it, it was originally for another poet that I appreciate, George Schurtes. This was written kind of in dedication to him. But reading it back now, it's really a poem about the construction of oneself, which I think is so important in this time when so many of us are feeling a certain sense of deconstruction, being bereft of all the kind of regular touchstones and anchors by which we might define ourselves. So this is Mythos, which was originally written for George Surtees. Do write poems for the poets that you appreciate, I would say that. Mythos. One, a part of you walks across a border and a part of you never stops, so that everything becomes the journey. A sense of belonging nagging underfoot like a stone caught in your shoe. Two, tell me again the story of the man who sat to the table to dine on a tongue, how he morseled the flesh of it. Not unlike a magician who, after swallowing a rope of knotted handkerchiefs, unlocks his jaw to birth a startled dove. Three, you build a house. Paint each wall the color of a different vowel. Invite your various selves in, Hungarian, Jew, hitchhiker thumbing the road from Leeds, boy caught in the mirror of his mother's lens and forever curving back to himself, or perhaps away. Four, a part of you walks across a border and a part of you never stops, a town of your own construction on your back. Within that town, a cobbled courtyard, a space filled with a song that will demand your voice, but not yet. Thank you. And thank you, Jaqueline Saphra. And thank you to all the poets that have gathered in Jaqueline's name. Have a good evening.
Thank you for that beautiful poem. Although it was for George, it felt very universal as well. So my next guest is Anja Konig. We met on an Avon masterclass probably about 15 years ago now. Feels like a long time, and we very often swap and share work. I always think of Anja as a person who will never use two words when one will do, and that works brilliantly in all her poetry. Her first pamphlet, Advice for an Only Child, was published by Flipped Eye, again, my first publisher, and was nominated for the Michael Marks Award, which was, and I was lucky to be her plus one, went along, very fancy affair, canapes and, you know, delicious dinner, and wonderful poetry. Her most recent collection, Animal Experiments, from the magnificent Bad Betty Press, is an absolute marvel, and has some of her most heartbreaking, tough, political, precise poems in it. I do recommend it. Anja was the other person alongside Miriam who was beside me every step of the way as I worked through this book. And she was also writing a sonnet a day. Some beautiful work emerged and some of it has been published already. And when I think of Anja, I think of Dishoom again. She's very fond of the bottomless chai. I also think of her striding around London and drinking up all the art and culture on her visits because she lives in Zurich. And I think of her training me to stride up the Swiss Alps, actually, this August in that brief window when we all had a bit more freedom, making me do things I really didn't believe I could do. And I also think of the time we met at the Hearst in another life. So it is my great pleasure and honour to welcome Anja.
Thank you, Jackie. And actually, it was George Surtis who was teaching the masterclass where we met. So I picked Jackie's poem from the 14th of April, Sonnet 23. The epigraph is by Governor Andrew Cuomo of New York. Yes, I think you can say that the worst is over. London's gone psychedelic. Parakeets glow luminous through branches. The high grass is surely tripping with the trees on speed. The sky is flirty blue. The clouds are cast in platinum. Leaf speaks in tongues of awe as fledgling redbreasts get their kicks on Stepney Green, crowdsourcing their songs. Nature performs her usual tricks, pulling chicks from eggs and rabbits out of rabbits, voila. And today I'm walking out with Dolly Parton, 9 to 5, glutted with song and color, sun turned to extra shine, my heart on double shifts. A shaking happiness steals in. It will not last. I hold it while I can. So it was with Jackie at Dishoom where I found out that 10 bottomless chais is really the limit that the human metabolism can cope with. And Jackie knows what, there's quite a lot of caffeine in these chais. These are the same cafes that we all seem to be overlapping in. So for my own poem, I actually picked the poem that I wrote on that same day, the 14th of April. And it's not really a sonnet. It's a found poem with 14 entries from the Heart Island Archive. The Heart Island Potter's Field is on Heart Island near New York. And it's where traditionally people are buried whom nobody comes to claim. April 14th, 14 entries found in the Heart Island Archive. Plot 149, Alphonse Bloch. Born August 23rd, 1894 in New York, salesman, medical supplies. Plot 149, Henry Rosario. Guess what, Dad? I'm so happy Nicole and I went to see you. I hope you like the flowers. We will be working very hard to get you out of this place. You deserve better. Plot 150, Claudie Dyson, born 1917 in Louisiana, as per the 1940 census, he had a wife named Murtis. Plot 148, June Betts, beloved mother of two sons, Donald and Stevie, who are in heaven with her, and one daughter, Diane. Sadly, she passed away in a New York City motel room. Plot 46, my son, Gabriele Flores, was stillborn. I have no money to bury him. Plot 175, female unknown, age 25, buried for 33 years. Plot 145, in June 1983, John Restuccio was found floating in the East River, an apparent suicide. The body was held 3 weeks, waiting for someone to claim it. Plot 131, Paul Lapidus received his medical degree from the University of Odessa. Always interested in orthopedic foot pathology, he completed a chapter on the toenail shortly before his death. Plot 131, Hay Krikor Kutunyan was born 1896 in Aydınab, Turkey. In 1920, he traveled to the US on the ship La Lorraine. They were ethnic Armenians. Plot 136, William Heitzman was a punk musician who went by the name of Billy Balls. In summer 1982, Billy was shot in his storefront apartment by an unknown person. He lived for 10 days before dying. Plot 137, Mr. Farrick fell into drugs early, went to prison for helping a female companion rob her parents and try to kill them, and died under the wheels of an L train at the Bedford Avenue stop. Plot 42, Tasha was a good baby. Mommy died just 6 months after Tasha died. Tasha Walker was my baby sister. Plot 168, Roosevelt Dunn is buried on the eastern shore of Hart Island. His grave can now be re-excavated. No one is buried forever in New York. Plot 189, Anne Rubin, the mother who never came home.
Thank you very much, Anja. I'm thinking about death stealing the show, and it certainly does in that poem. Thank you. So my last guest is none other than Ian McMillan. What a mensch, we would say in Yiddish. We all know he's a generous, open-hearted presenter and critic, a kind of national treasure, that he's a major promoter of poetry, that he injects life and levity into everything he does, and that he tweets all kinds of fun things every day. I found out that he's poet in residence for the Academy of Urbanism and also for Barnsley FC. His heart is definitely in Barnsley. He presents The Verb every week on BBC Three, and you'll find him on other radio programmes and BBC Breakfast and Pick of the Week and You and Yours and The Arts Show. He's been a castaway on Desert Island Discs and the subject of a South Bank show. And he doesn't blow his own trumpet very much at all. But he also is a very fine poet, and he certainly keeps that fairly quiet compared to his other activities. While I was writing my sonnets, he was on a parallel track writing his own book of sonnets, which is published by Barnsley Libraries, and also issuing videos teaching people how to write sonnets. So we were really working on parallel paths. This book, the Poets in Lockdown from Barnsley Libraries, is a very, very moving document, and I heartily recommend it. You'll love it, and it might make you cry. It certainly made me cry. Ian's actually written a brand new sonnet specially for this evening, and how wonderful is that? And it's all about sonnets. When I think of Ian in the other world, I think of being backstage at the festival hall and shivering with cold, and he was just such a comfort. I think it wasn't actually cold, I think it was nerves. But he was a very comforting presence. And I also think of the studio at The Verb after the radio programme, when they offered us three different types of cake. I know cake's been mentioned quite a lot this evening, but it can only be a good thing, right? So anyway, without further ado, Jane will play the video of Ian McMillan.
Hello everybody, Ian McMillan here with my lockdown no haircut speaking to you from my little book room in Barnsley. I'm proud to be a small part of the launch of Jacqueline Saphra's fantastic new book, 100 Lockdown Sonnets, which does exactly what it says on the tin. Jacqueline set herself the not inconsiderable task of writing a sonnet a day for months in what we're now calling the first lockdown. Now, the sonnet can be a slippery beast. It can just be a technical exercise. But Jacqueline has imbued her sonnets with skill and craft and love and emotion. And in years to come, when PhD students are writing theses on what 2020 was like, they'll turn to Jacqueline's sonnets when they're writing them. And they'll get a good mark. And they'll deserve it. I've written a poem about sonnets called Sonnet Sonnet, because I think what Jacqueline shows us all is the range of what a sonnet can do, and I've tried to just make a list.
Hi everybody, sorry, I think we've just had a technical issue there with Ian's film. What I'm going to do, I think my video has just temporarily closed down, so I do apologise. We're going to try that again. Bear with me. Sorry, please bear with me, everybody. We're just going to try the video again. I'm afraid we're just having some technical issues with Ian's video.
Hello everybody, Ian McMillan here with my lockdown, no haircut, speaking to you from my little book room in Barnsley. I'm proud to be a small part of.
Apologies everybody, we're nearly there. I'm just going to hopefully now share with you Ian's video. Thank you for your patience while I just get this up and running. Okay. I'm sorry, Jacqueline, I'm having some problems with Ian's video. Might we ask I think if I just try one more time to queue it up, let me try that. I think what's happened is the PowerPoint we had Ian's video in has crashed, unfortunately. I'm going to try it one more time and hopefully this time it will work. What we'll do is I will check in with Naomi and with Ian after today's launch. And what I will do is ask them both if they're happy for us to perhaps pop these up onto the Nine Arches YouTube for a little while. So if there have been any technical issues with viewing these, we can hopefully get them up and running. We tried all of this earlier and it worked beautifully, but as is often the way with live events, unfortunately this time we've just had a few issues with getting that particular video to work. So I'm just going to queue that up with my apologies to everyone and apologies to all of our readers and Jacqueline. I'll just get this queued up and ready for you, and then we shall go. And I'm just going to return to Zoom with you all. Thank you very much. Jacqueline, would you like to reintroduce Ian's video and we'll relaunch it? We're going to go for one more try. Hopefully this will work this time. I do apologise to everybody and I'm sorry if anyone's experiencing poor quality with this video, but hopefully this will work this time. Thank you.
Okay, I obviously won't do the whole introduction. I'll just say that I'm really hoping that you'll be able to watch Ian's video because it is so great. So I'm keeping my fingers crossed for the that it will work this time. Off you go, Jane.
Hello, everybody. Ian McMillan here with my lockdown, no haircut haircut, speaking to you from my little book room in Barnsley. I'm proud to be a small part of the launch of Jacqueline Saphra's fantastic new book, 100 Lockdown Sonnets, which does exactly what it says on the tin. Jacqueline set herself the not inconsiderable task of writing a sonnet a day for months in what we're now calling the first lockdown. Now, the sonnet can be a slippery beast. It can just be a technical exercise. But Jacqueline has imbued her sonnets with skill and craft and love and emotion. And in years to come, when PhD students are writing theses on what 2020 was like, they'll turn to Jacqueline's sonnets when they're writing them and they'll get a good mark and they'll deserve it. I've written a poem about sonnets called Sonnet Sonnet because I think what Jacqueline shows us all is the range of what a sonnet can do, and I've tried to just make a list really of what a sonnet can do and what a sonnet can be. Sonnet Sonnet. Small pebble, small puddle, 14 ripples spreading from a single tensile mind splash, a run of tattoos, shoulder to knuckles, drawn on the body's warm blank page of flesh. Stories wandering into the end rhyme, syllables inching their way through meaning, rhythm trying not to be a trombone in a jazz band's last number, moons gleaming on Jeanmont between clouds hung in two lines. Little song, come over here. Sing to me in your gilded cage, in your tight confines, in your old forest that grows tree by tree. Everything's possible. Everything's here. Wipe life with a sonnet. All will come clear. And it strikes me that that's what Jacqueline does. She wipes life with a sonnet. This is her sonnet from the 3rd of June. And it starts with an epigraph from the Daily Telegraph. Will hairdressers really reopen on July the 4th? It was early March, just a dream ago. I last sat in that chair when hair mattered and chattered about this and that. So, Matteo, I asked, how are things in Italy? He cleared his throat and laughed. Business is picking up, he said, feathering my fringe into my eyes. My papa's still at work, living above the shop. Locked down, not a problem, he snipped and smiled. Family business, he giggled, looking smug. Hair? I asked. No, no, he answered. Undertakers. He asked about my holidays. I shrugged. Sicily's nice, he said, turning on the shaver, his warm breath on my neck. Did I laugh? It seemed funny at the time. Now, not so much. Jacqueline's book is full of sonnets with that level of skill and that level of engagement. So I would encourage you to buy it and tell other people about the book. But tell them in sonnet form, of course. That's essential.
I was just about to say thank you, Ian, because it almost felt as if he was live. I just loved the sonnet that he wrote about all the things that a sonnet can be. And what was interesting about this process was inviting the readers to choose which sonnets they wanted to read. And none of them chose the ones that I wanted to read, which was quite convenient. And none of them chose the sonnets that other people had chosen. So I guess there must be something in there for everyone somewhere. So I want to say thank you before I hand over to Jane and before she hands over to me for one last poem. But especially thank you to all the readers. You are fantastic. And thank you to Jane for keeping your cool under extremely tight technical circumstances. I'm so pleased we were able to watch that video. Jane?
Thank you, Jacqueline, and thank you everybody for bearing with us while we got through the little technical gremlins just there. I'm so glad that we managed to watch both videos, and apologies if anyone's had slightly lower quality resolution as a result of some of the tech issues we're having, but hopefully everything looks fairly good in YouTube. I think just perhaps a little bit of an issue with that video. I do apologise. Thank you so much to everybody who's joined us this evening. I have been looking at the comments on YouTube as we've been going along, and it's been wonderful to just experience the warmth and generosity from our lovely audience, to hear all of your lovely comments, to hear you cheering us on. I think that means so much right now. And what has really come across from this evening's readings is warmth, community, connection, all of those things that poetry gives us, not just in the poems themselves, but in the fellowship with each other as poets, with other writers, with our audiences, with our readerships, with people appreciating a poem because it's moved them or spoken to them or done something for them in some way. So that sense of connection, something we're all very much missing and craving right now, I think is something that the art of poetry really excels at enabling us to have. And how wonderful we have had also in terms of community readers who have been a really big part of Jacqueline's own story, and I'm so grateful. I have many thank yous to say tonight, and the first are to Miriam, to Jacob, to Anja, also to Ian and to Naomi for joining us this evening. It has just been wonderful to have your readings, to have your own poems as a gift as part of this evening too. And thank you also for picking your favourite poems from Jacqueline's collection and sharing them so beautifully with the audience. I should also mention a few other little thank yous. As the copies of 100 Lockdown Sonnets wing their way in the post to readers, I really hope that you enjoy reading them. You will notice this beautiful illustration on the cover, a beautiful artwork. And without giving away too much, those gorgeous illustrations continue throughout the book. We sort of just give you a little preview. All of these have been designed and made by the wonderful artist and fellow poet Sophie Herxheimer. Sophie has very kindly printed, along with Suki from the printing block, these beautiful one-off prints, exclusive screen prints. If you want one, they are available in the Nine Arches shop. We are selling them at $24.99 with all proceeds to the Trussell Trust. So please, if you're interested in one, give us a shout. Pop along to the Nine Arches shop and we'll make sure that all of that $24.99 then goes to the Trussell Trust. So they're available. And a huge thank you. There's been lots of people making donations throughout this evening, and that is enormously generous of you. Thank you so much for helping us to make our stretch target of £500 towards supporting the Trussell Trust. And I hope that the funds can go a little way towards ending hunger and poverty in this time of crisis. And just to say how incredible, finally, to say my thank yous to Jacqueline herself as well, to be entrusted with this book of poems, this very special and incredible book of poems, has been a real pleasure and a privilege. I can't think of a better way to have marked our 100th publication than to have had the absolute pleasure of working with Jacqueline on this. These are poems of incredible scope, and as a fellow writer, I'm in awe of anyone who can write and respond to the events around them, not least with the skill, the empathy, the care, the sheer thoughtful engagement that I think Jacqueline's poems show. They're poems that engage with quite a lot of difficult things, with fear and anxiety, but also with joy, and they examine what it means to live through the times that we're living through. It's an extraordinary book of poems. Thank you, Jacqueline, for entrusting them to Nine Arches. It's been a total pleasure. So we shall release this beautiful book now out into the world. And I'm going to invite Jacqueline to read one final poem, and then all poets will return to the screen and we will wave you good night. And we will thank you for having joined us. We will applaud each other, and then we will vanish from your screens for this evening. But before we do that, just say enormous thank you from Nine Arches Press, from myself, Jane Kermaine, from Angela Hicken, who's in the background looking after YouTube and doing all of the work that helps make these events happen. We hope you have a wonderful evening. Stay well, stay safe, and please enjoy one more poem from the wonderful Jacqueline Saphra.
Thank you, Jane. Jane said all the thank yous, and I've said a lot of thank yous, so I won't carry on with the thank yous because I'm sure you all want to eat your dinner. I also want to say how happy I am to be supporting the Trussell Trust, and how glad I am that we've managed to sell all these books and reach the target, the funding target. I find it shocking that in one of the richest countries of the world, there are still people who are hungry and who need food banks. So I think we all need to support the Trussell Trust, who are not just providing food, but also campaigning against hunger. Thank you all very much for coming. That's the other thing. Thank you all just for being here. It's been a weird and wonderful experience to read into a screen. And I hope we'll see each other in real life, not in the not too distant future. This is Sonnet 100. It's the 30th of June. Here we are in third lockdown. I think we could have seen this was coming. COVID death toll passes 500,000 worldwide, said the BBC News. This is the 30th of June. Cannibal rats are among the grimmest consequences of the upending of urban life, says The Guardian. And that old song of Katy Perry, just because it's over doesn't mean it's really over. My loves, this is my last. I tip my hat, I scrawl a wild hurrah, I lightly trip into the red beyond. Stiff upper lip, relief, day of the dirt, day of the rats who eat their own. The rising numbers crack their own facade, the sonnet slowly sips its morning tea and speaks. Let's call it quits, to hell with poetry, bring on the maniacs. There will be greater griefs. The leading man is muck and splutter, and he has no plan. The virus finds its host. The wars go on, the markets rise and fall, the earth is spent. I hold the sonnet close, my faithful friend, and hear it sigh. Damn, it says. We are not done. Thank you.
A huge thank you to everybody. We're going to wave goodnight to you all. Our readers will vanish into their digital green rooms, but thank you to our lovely audience for joining us. Thank you for being live with us. And thank you again to our wonderful readers, Jacob Samler-Rose, Anja Konig, Miriam Nash, Jacqueline Saphra, Ian McMillan, and Naomi Shihab. Good night, everybody. Take care.
Just put it's about to begin instead of it's finished.